This video is sponsored by Ren. Hey, come here. Did you hear about what's been happening? Schools are keeping litter boxes in their classrooms for children that identify as like animals, like cats and dogs, to pee in. It's a trans thing, hella LGBT. See?
U.S. Representative Lauren Boebert spoke at a Mesa County Republican women's luncheon on Monday, where she mentioned she received a call last week from a father whose kid was in trouble at school because he, quote, stepped on a furry.
They are putting litter boxes in schools for people who identify as cats,
Boebert said.
They are doing this. This is how extreme it is.
Unbelievable, right? Thankfully, people with an ounce of decency are standing up against this woke garbage. Doesn't it seem like common sense is like an exclusively Republican virtue now?
My friend, his wife, is a school teacher, and she works at a school that had to install a litter box in the girls' room because there is a girl who's a furry who identifies as an animal, and her mother badgered the school until they agreed to put a litter box in one of the stalls. You've conned the school into putting this litter box in a girl's room.
Yeah.
Which is bananas.
It is.
You've got to admit, it's a sensational story. Can you imagine? Children using litter boxes in school bathrooms sounds ridiculous. It's nearly unbelievable. Last week they had babies choosing their pronouns, and now they've got toddlers choosing their species. What's next? The complete dissolution of heterosexuality altogether? Critical ace theory?
What are we doing to our kids? Why are we telling elementary kids that they get to choose their gender this week? Why do we have litter boxes in some of the school districts so kids can pee in them? Because they identify as a furry? We've lost our minds. We've lost our minds.
And you know,
I heard a rumor.
I think I agree.
I heard a rumor.
They've lost their goddamn minds.
I heard a rumor.
I heard a rumor that he was trans.
I heard a rumor there.
What is a rumor?
There's something going on in the basement at Conrad.
I heard a rumor they're indoctrinating kids.
Kitty litter in classrooms.
Burned down entire cities.
We've got what is a groomer, what is a rumor. Next, I'm doing what is a boomer, like some sort of sick Dr. Seussification of this channel. In this episode, we're going to talk about yellow journalism. But like, what even is yellow journalism? I literally don't know. So I'm making my boyfriend write this part. He's writing these very words right now. He's using my mouth. The term yellow journalism was coined by Irwin Wardman, the editor of the New York Press, back in the mid-1890s. It characterizes the sensationalist style of journalism used in William Randolph Hearst's New York Journal and Joseph Pulitzer's New York World, among other newspapers during the circulation wars. These papers relied on exaggerated versions of events and used scandal-mongering as a way of, like, drumming up late 19th century engagement in hopes of going viral. Which reminds me,
I heard a rumor that you liked, commented, and subscribed.
If YouTube sees you doing that, like, during the video, the algorithm is so much nicer to it. They're like, damn, must be a good one if they couldn't wait. Often, yellow journalism is seen as an American-only thing. But that's often just due to naming conventions. What's often called tabloid journalism, you know, dramatized, often unverifiable, or even straight up false news, goes all the way back to London, England in the 1770s, where scandal sheets were popularized. As the name suggests, these specialized in rumors and malicious gossip, often for political or personal motivation. In conjunction with the increasingly industrialized portion of the printing revolution, scandal sheets were also seen in the US as early as the 1840s, where they were routinely used as the means of blackmail and extortion. If I ever get pet rats again, I'm naming them blackmail and extortion. In the book American Journalism, historian Frank Luther Mott identified five characteristics with respect to yellow journalism.
Scare headlines in huge print, often of minor news. Lavish use of pictures or imaginary drawings. Use of faked interviews, misleading headlines, pseudoscience, and a parade of false learning from so-called experts. Emphasis on full-color Sunday supplements, usually with comic strips. Dramatic sympathy with the underdog against the system.
So basically, a bunch of people that were rich enough to own, produce, and sell media that sought to influence people's thoughts and behaviors did exactly that, and with some pettiness sprinkled on top. And we all know I stand a bit of petty. I used to love the weekly world news tabloids in the grocery store aisle. For a while, I saved up money from doing chores so I could buy them. I knew they were garbage, of course, but I found them so captivating, especially my childhood idol, Bat Boy. Anyone else obsess over him? Let me know in the comments if you're a Bat Boy stan too, and maybe we can start like a cute little cult. The problem with these circulation wars between Pulitzer and Hearst was they weren't occurring in some consequence-free marketplace simulation designed to see what drives newspaper sales. It was happening alongside Cuba's War of Independence against Spain. Reporters for the New York papers wrote stories designed to garner support for the Cuban rebels by relying on exaggerated depictions of prisoners, executions, and starving Cuban women and children. Then, on February 15, 1898, when an American battleship that had been deployed from Florida to Havana sank from an onboard explosion, Hearst, with no evidence, publicly blamed the Spanish in print. With the excessive use of rumors and embellished reporting, the yellow journalism of the time helped fuel the pro-war rhetoric and sentiment that culminated in the Spanish-American War in Cuba and the Philippines. Although there are many factors at play, the constant stream of sensational headlines and stories contributed to the hashtag vibes for America's intervention in Cuba, which had some pretty serious consequences down the line. It's also why this war is referred to as the first media or press-driven war. But like, why? What was the point of all of this? Put simply, egos and agendas. To do any of this, you have to have a big, throbbing, veiny ego. I don't want this video to become a history lesson, but like, go look into William Randolph Hearst and tell me you don't see hella parallels. Hearst was born to a millionaire gold mine owner, was seen as a titan of industry, claimed to be a populist, but gradually became more conservative and had people convinced he was a smarty pants worth listening to. He was even the main inspiration for the lead character in Orson Welles' Citizen Kane. Hearst, upset with the character's portrayal, used his power and influence to try and prevent the film's release, even though he never saw it, and succeeded in limiting the amount of showings and box office success the film received. Aside from ego, though, the most obvious answer is, obviously, they do it for the money. Scandal sheets and early tabloid papers would routinely engage in blackmail, sell positive mentions or stories to people looking to do a little PR, and charge suppression fees to keep harmful stories unpublished. By doing this, Hearst and Pulitzer were able to boost both their newspaper sales and their advertising revenue. Crucial, but still not the whole picture. They also did this for political and ideological motivations, who'd have thunk. Using lurid and profane accusations, aka slander and libel, if I ever get rats again, I'm naming them slander and libel. Using lurid and profane accusations ended up being a powerful way to tarnish someone's reputation. And it worked great during political elections. It was also an effective way to demonize and otherize someone or an entire group of someone's whomst thou disagreed with. With yellow journalism, there was an attempted populism, but with an inherent conservatism in its content. There was an appeal to Joe Basic, the common everyday individual, using the sympathy for and identification with the underdog, yes. But the reliance on melodramatic and scandalous stories as a way of getting those old-timey folks to be like, "My word, how horrible," is kind of reactionary, especially when all that takes is saying someone got drunk and had sex or something, also known as a Tuesday. These were rumors, some true, some not, but never, you know, anything that matters. But enough about the future. And you know what? Enough about the past. As my cousin Rafiki used to say, it doesn't matter, it's in the past, your dad is dead, you're an orphan, stop crying and move on, you need to defeat your uncle's skin tag. And like, I have to say, sometimes history is soup's boring. Me and my besties are alive in the right now, not all the way in the back then. So in a world where traditional media like newspapers have been largely replaced with social media, and the war we're entrenched in day to day is a deeply cultural one, how does yellow journalism play out online? Obviously, tabloids and other legacy formats still exist, but how have the dynamics evolved, and what does that look like in the more participatory mediums of the internet? Let's revisit some of the characteristics that Mr. Mott identified. Thank you, journalist history daddy. First off, there's the reliance on scare and or misleading headlines, often of minor news. So like titles that are a little extra and maybe even deceptive. You know, a clickbait. I'm really good at this
analysis
thing. What was next? The lavish use of pictures or imaginary drawings. If you had no knowledge of the history we've covered so far and just heard the description of lavish pictures with huge print, you'd immediately think of memes. Just like the newspapers of old and tabloids lining the grocery store checkout line, your standard meme pairs a visual with text that delivers a very immediate framing, often in a bold impact font and all caps. Unlike a video essay, which is chock full of context and so nuanced, a meme communicates a lot with very little. It's that juxtaposition of quick simplicity with communicative complexity that makes a meme so powerful. The roots of yellow journalism directly parallels the meme-laden culture of today. The expression yellow journalism itself evolved from yellow kid journalism, which was a reference to a popular character that appeared in both Hearst's and Pulitzer's papers. The Yellow Kid was created by cartoonist Richard F. Outcault. I hope I'm saying that right. The comics are still considered very influential for popularizing the use of word bubbles. Again, pairing text with visuals, despite the comics being pretty sus in terms of their content. She wasn't Kathy. The character The Yellow Kid and the content of the comic strip The Yellow Kid was, in fact, deeply frickin' racist. The character of The Yellow Kid managing to be both anti-Asian and anti-Irish. The Yellow Kid and the comic strips were so popular that Hearst hired Outcault full-time and gave him a full-page color strip with free rein to take things in more violent and vulgar directions. But since Outcault failed to copyright his dunks, Pulitzer just hired a different cartoonist to continue doing the comics with the same character in his paper, like it was nothing. Not these freaks just copying, one-upping, sharing each other's analog memes for clout. So embarrassing. It's giving, don't mind if I steal your meme energy. When I was going through this list and thinking about the use of faked interviews, pseudoscience, and a parade of false learning from so-called experts, I immediately think of personalities like Joe Rogan. The conversational interview format of his podcast rarely features fact checks or pushback on what are often rumors or exaggerated claims stated as objective fact. And a lot of his guests happen to be expert grifters pushing pseudoscience. From Joe Rogan to boomers on Facebook, the fake newsification of online spaces is something we're all familiar with now, where misleading or false information is presented as factual. Since there's so much fake news online today and in so many different forms, it's actually exacerbated what researchers call information disorder syndrome. This refers to the sharing or developing of false information with or without the intent of harming. The severity of the syndrome can be categorized into three tiers: misinformation, disinformation, and malinformation. Rat names. Misinformation is the milder form where someone shares false info without the intent of harming others. Like, we all make mistakes sometimes. Hitting the share button on something you didn't fact check doesn't mean you have ill intent. Disinformation is a moderate form and is where someone develops and shares false information with the intent of making money or for political gain. Of course, disinformation can still be harmful, but harm is not the motivation. For that, that's where you get malinformation, the naughtiest form, which is when somebody knowingly develops and shares false information with the explicit intent of harming people. Your libs of TikTok or Blair White's, which is the most dangerous, as many of these people have hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of subscribers or followers. You might be thinking, this sounds familiar. You might be thinking, I want fries. But if you are thinking it sounds familiar, that would be because it also sounds like the same thing those olden timers were doing with their scandalous sheets, their yellowest tabloids. All right, I forgot, nothing ever changes except for when it gets worse. Not only do mis, dis, and malinformation influence the framing on topics in terms of what and how people think, all of this noise, this static, creates a perfect breeding ground for pseudoscience, vaccine misinformation, moral panics, and other dangerous conspiracies. Damn, I talk a lot. Speaking of conspiracies, there's also this big lie aspect to all this stuff where the claims are batshit unhinged, but people accept them because, like, No one would distort the truth that much, right? I know I'll be accused of being an online leftist, and that's fair, but that's some shit. The big lie refers to a propaganda technique that purposefully distorts or misrepresents the truth. Hitler and the Nazis used this technique to tap into long-standing anti-Semitism and create the all-powerful Jewish people scapegoat that's still popular today. Not only that, Hitler claimed in Mein Kampf that the technique had actually been used by Jewish people themselves to blame Germany's loss in World War I on General Erich Ludendorff and begin a war of extermination against Germany in an attempt to prime people to be okay with genocidal self-defense. She's giving fascistic contradiction, like when I see these girlies online talk about how it's actually the left who are hateful and just want to take all your rights away, gobble them up. Or to say how weak these soy-eating woke LGBTQ plus feminist types are, but that they also like control powerful corporate agendas and the media. Basically, if you claim outrageous things that reinforce or play off of myths about communities that have been historically otherized, people that are already amenable to the messaging will believe it. And that's kind of scary because when we've all been socialized in the same societies that hold those long-standing beliefs or sentiments, we're all susceptible to this dangerous dynamic. Last on Mott's list of characteristics is dramatic sympathy with the underdog against the system. Better yet, let's make that dramatic sympathy with the perceived underdog against the perceived system. There's so many examples of this, but in keeping with the conspiracy theme, look no further than QAnon. I always say Quanon in my head. The underlying conspiratorial claims made by QAnon boil down to this. Some of the most elite members of American society, like Donald Trump, are actually the ones leading the charge against the actual elite members of American society or something. But wait, there's also child sacrifice and pizza basements, maybe. And also everything is the fault of Jewish people? I don't know. It honestly all sounds like the ramblings of someone who would be silly enough to file a defamation lawsuit leading to a discovery process where it was found that while they were 25, they groomed a 15-year-old for sex, all while being instrumental in creating an online cult of conspiracy centered around stopping powerful people from committing acts of pedophilia. RIP QAnon Tom. On its own, a lie told in a vacuum has no effect, but the dangerous thing about rumors is they spread. QAnon left the obscure areas of the internet where it started and manifested into the eventual storming of the US Capitol building and attempts to overturn a presidential election. The short, sweet, and highly memeable slogan of Stop the Steal shows the big lie technique in full force. Billionaire and former president Donald Trump wasn't the one exercising his power to try and game the system for his personal and political gain. No, baby girl. He was an underdog fighting against the deep state and the real powers that be. He literally knew he had lost the election, but lied and said the election was a lie. It's like that stupid, sexy snake that's always eating itself. The Aurora Borealis. Propaganda scholars maintain that to persuade people to believe extreme things or extreme versions of things, it requires constant repetition of the falsehoods in a variety of media, plus a psychological motivation. Which brings us to Elon Musk. You know, little hoots boss, and the so-called Twitter files. This man, while in the midst of doing every other destructive thing he's doing to Twitter, found time to give curated information to select journalists that then shared it on the platform he owns in an effort to show all the suppression of speech that was occurring prior to his freedom of speech loving ass buying Twitter. Extra, proof of conservatives being silenced in cases where they violated Twitter policy. Meanwhile, actual proof was being leaked in these same documents that stochastic terrorist libs of TikTok was basically getting carte blanche to violate Twitter policy. As these big reveals of suppression and shadow banning were occurring, Elon came down from the mount to giveth unto us his new Twittereth policyeth. Freedom of speech, but not freedom of reach, which is like a fun way of saying you can say whatever you want, but you will be silenced to the same effect as if you had never said it to begin with. Given Elon's steep slide into alt-right political spheres, I have doubts that this policy will be applied to anything useful, like misinformation about vaccines or climate change. Speaking of climate change, what these publications should be focusing on are the very issues their petty drama is meant to distract us from. Things that are actually sensational, not mountains made out of molehills. Because there are legitimately important stories that would sell papers too. Like the fact that the entire planet and every living thing on it is in danger, girl. The globe, she's warming. The climate, she's changing. The oceans, she's rising. But when it comes to climate change, it can be really overwhelming figuring out how to get your feet wet, metaphorically. Earlier this year, I released an episode called We Can Save the Planet, in which I posit that while it's true that individual action is going to stop climate change, we are absolutely not powerless. And while I don't believe individual action is the end goal, I think it's where a passion for real change in society is probably going to start. In my opinion, a great entry point into this is Wren. I am currently obsessed with agroforestry and the return to indigenous farming practices, and Wren funds farmers so they can do just that. Through their community tree planting program, the Wren Initiative funds TIST, a program in which subsistence farmers organize themselves to plant trees on their degraded land and improve their livelihoods and address local, regional, and global environmental issues, such as deforestation, and the results of which that include biodiversity loss, poverty, and vulnerability to climate change. The community tree planting program is actually the program that convinced me to sign up myself. When I signed up, it only took like 2 minutes. I went to Wren.co and there was a short quiz to calculate my carbon footprint. I answered a couple questions and it gave me a chart on what my footprint likely is. Then you can offset that by supporting programs on Wren. My favorites right now are the community tree planting program I mentioned and the rainforest protection program in Baja, Amazonas, Peru. All the communities participating in Rainforest Alert have reported successful decreases in deforestation. Four of them have even used payments from Wren to help legally register their lands as indigenous territories, advancing their efforts to protect their rainforests and their homes. The funding also goes towards like sustainable infrastructure, solar panels, water filtration, communal boats, and agricultural equipment, which means those indigenous communities can now decide for themselves what they need, rather than having outsiders dictate that to them. So far, over twice the size of Osaka in indigenous lands have been reclaimed. Once you sign up for monthly contributions, they send you updates and photos of the trees planted, areas reforested, and new information about the projects you're funding. I got one recently about the tests they're funding to examine mineral weathering in Scotland in order to learn how to keep the soil from degrading, which is a serious issue when it comes to farming. New third fave for me. I love dirt science. So if you're looking for a way to easily support climate initiatives that make tangible differences in the lives of people who will be the most affected by climate change, offset your carbon footprint on Wren. The first 100 people to sign up to Wren using my link will get their first month of the subscription for free. Literally, it will cost you $0 and you'll help with so many dope initiatives that have real effects for real people. Speaking of climate change, and no, it's not another ad read,
I heard a rumor that Americans don't even need to worry about climate change anymore.
Because the whole place is already a literal wasteland. Every major city, just ash. All because of the riots started by BLM Lives Matter in 2020.
All this political violence has happened all throughout 2020. We saw what they call the Summer of Love, and we had all of our major cities burned to the ground. We had cops killed. We had buildings looted. We had places burned to the ground.
And I just want to know how many BLM riots were prevented because we got in on the inside before they rioted, burned down cities.
Very interesting.
Never ahead of that curve.
Never. Never.
Biden is communist being hypocrites. Notice how the left always condemns January 6th, yet never condemns radical communist BLM Antifa activists for burning and looting to the ground 1 million cities.
Okay. First of all, as of right now, there are only 19,000 cities in the United States. And unless in 2019 there were 1,019 cities, I'm gonna call Belante on this one. Also, how do you loot a city to the ground? Were looters scaling buildings so they could stuff their bags full of roof shingles, looting a city's worth of bricks into the back of their Honda Civics, and burn to the ground? Like, if there were even a single city burned to the ground, that would make the events of 9/11 look like frickin' DashCon. I am dying to know how many Americans in my audience heard someone say something like this to them, or how many people outside the US heard it, because I heard it up here in Canada. Get in the comment section and explain yourselves, because I have so many questions about this one. I mean, the results of this propaganda is not funny at all, but the idea of someone believing this is so preposterous to me. Like, how do I say this without triggering YouTube's these people went down to Comet Pizza to K-word Peter's files, who were apparently rooming KIDS in the basement that didn't exist. They can do that, but they can't get on a train to check if Chicago is a literal crater. If you want actual instances of out-of-control gangs causing widespread damage to American cities, may I point you in the direction of the police. In 1985, two explosive devices were dropped by a police helicopter on the roof of a house owned by Black Liberation Group MOVE, causing a fire which the Philadelphia Fire Department subsequently let burn out of control, causing it to destroy 61 neighboring houses over two city blocks and leaving 250 people homeless. But sure, I'm gonna mourn over one of a city's 12 Best Buys having their window smashed in by Boogaloo Boys. So we have our misleading scare headline, Black Lives Matter burned down entire cities. And then paired with sensational over-the-top images, some real, some not, a rumor becomes a story being sold. The purpose of which is to stoke the fires of fear to both other and demonize Black people and to bolster support for white supremacy. And legions of people who haven't shopped at a store other than Walmart in the last 15 years began crying about a handful of local businesses. And we can all empathize with those business owners, with losing something we value, something we work hard for, something that allows us to provide for ourselves and others. But I care a lot more about lost lives, about the communities that have to endure police violence every day. You know, the real underdogs. I care more about a 12-year-old boy being shot to death for carrying a toy gun than vandalism at a vape shop. The truth is the BLM protests were overwhelmingly peaceful, and most of the riots that did occur were caused by the police. And I mean, technically, all the riots were caused by the police. That the media was able to convince swaths of Americans that entire cities were burned to the ground by Black Antifa terrorists, as opposed to the truth, which is a relative handful of businesses and buildings were vandalized or destroyed by rioters, police, and fascists hoping to incite further riots. The fact that they were able to convince people of this is genuinely terrifying. If you can convince someone of this, you can convince someone of anything. And eventually, you can convince them enough that they start convincing themselves. In early September of 2021, a story broke that a teacher had been arrested for SAing a student. As soon as they possibly could, right-wing and gender-critical anti-trans activists began making some claims.
Does this mean he gets to be placed in a women's prison? Yeah, but self-ID is such a grand idea.
Thing is, Crystal Jackson? Not a man. Maybe not society's idea of a model, but definitely not a man. Turns out women can look all sorts of different ways. Something you'd hope that a person critical of gender would understand and take into consideration before tweeting things like,
"This is a biological man who RAPED'd a child. So bloody sick of this crap."
Or, incredibly ironically, another cis gender critical woman tweeting,
"These are not women's crimes."
It's a popular talking point among anti-trans gender critical activists that there are thousands of cases of trans women committing crimes, and those crimes are being attributed to real women by the media. I discussed this in my gender critical series, but TLDR, they take unrelated images of random people from the internet, sometimes not even a trans woman or a cis woman, but men who cross-dress or literal parody photos, and pair them with slogans like, "This man wants to change with your daughter." Like, no, that man was at a Halloween party. For the gender critical people in the audience, a party is something you get invited to when people enjoy your company. The more you know. The claim is that the crimes of trans people are being pinned on cis people, but when you look at the coverage in the media, you'll find that the opposite is much more frequent and much more widespread and much more damaging. Moments after the tragic shooting at the Robb Elementary School in Uvalde, Texas, misinformation began spreading about the identity of the gunman. Images of three different trans women were eventually shared online, claiming that each were the gunman, which led to a barrage of harassment and abuse, both of those trans women and trans people en masse. The malinformation was amplified by American politicians and political influencers who were attempting to conflate trans people with violence and danger, especially with danger to children. Almost immediately after the shooting, photos of the shooter began circulating. While he didn't have a large social media presence, one photo in particular was widely shared. It showed him looking in a mirror wearing a dark gray hoodie. The rumor that he was trans seems to have been born on 4chan, in particular on Poll, the politically incorrect board, where users posted an image of a woman they thought resembled the shooter with a link to her info, to her profile. This woman was trans, and they publicly and baselessly claimed she was the gunman. And as rumors are wont to do, it spread like wildfire. The claim began to be repeated by the far right and conservatives.
What drives an 18-year-old to murder innocent children? I don't know. But judging by the photos of him cross-dressing, we can assume there were plenty of signs that he was mentally disturbed and abused by adults in his life. Societal cowardice ignored those plenty of signs.
That tweet is still up to this day, by the way. Republican Congressman Paul Gosar repeated the trans claim in a tweet that he later silently deleted with no apology or retraction. Pete Sessions claimed in an interview on the Today program that wore dresses. The thing is, the shooter was shot dead by the police, and this trans woman was still posting on Reddit. She explained that she did live in Texas and, you know, was alive, but she was not the only trans person targeted by this rumor. Images of another trans woman appeared in photo collages alongside the actual photo of the gunman with similar false claims. And she was forced to combat the rumors by posting an image of herself holding her phone with the time and date visible to prove she was alive. And when she did that, they picked another trans person to pin it on. Her image also then appeared on 4chan and was then disseminated to other spaces, including conspiracy theorist Alec Jones's InfoWars website. And this is not even the first time this has happened. In 2018, there was a shooting at YouTube headquarters in San Bruno, California. Soon after the shooter was identified, several websites, alt-right and conservative critics, and gender-critical anti-trans activists began claiming that the shooter was a trans woman.
The hashtag YouTube shooter has very muscular thighs and buff arms. The oversized breasts in some of her pics look distorted with Photoshop. I don't think we're getting the full story.
In 2015, alt-right rag The Gateway Pundit reported that a Planned Parenthood shooter was registered to vote as female, a lead Ted Cruz circulated. The history of using journalism as a tool for painting marginalized people as violent, dangerous, and guilty of crimes they did not commit is long and unmistakably intentional. All of these stories started with a rumor, believable because the subjects of the rumors were already questionable to people, different, other, folk devils. Remember the kitty litter story? What was the purpose of that rumor? Was there ever a crumb of proof given? No. And of course, if you looked at the story logically, if there were hundreds of claims of litter boxes in schools, why had nobody ever seen one? Why was this always something they'd heard from a friend of a friend? Why not go into the school and walk into the bathroom? I think it's probably because they know what they would find, or rather, what they wouldn't find. But if you were to strip away everything from the story, except for the literal physical kitty litter itself, you could claim there's a speck of a kernel of truth, kind of. It's true that in one school district in Jefferson County, Colorado, the schools have been stocking classrooms with small amounts of kitty litter since 2017. They do this because on April 20th, 1999, two young men walked into a Jefferson County high school armed with semi-automatic rifles, pistols, and several explosives and killed 15 people, including themselves, and wounded 24 others. That school's name would permanently enter the zeitgeist, becoming synonymous with school shootings themselves. Columbine. So yeah. There is kitty litter stored in some classrooms' go buckets. And it's there because in the years since Columbine, nothing meaningful has been done by the government to prevent gun violence in schools, largely in part due to the same party that is now hyperventilating and shitting themselves behind their news desks, shrieking about the epidemic of cat people overtaking their schools. If anyone is at fault for putting kitty litter in your kids' classrooms, it's the people crying foul about it right now. But don't be fooled. The target of this kitty litter lie isn't actually furries, it's trans people. Notice how they consistently say identify as cats and not are furries. Key phrase being identify as. The purpose here is to repeatedly conflate this myth, a and all the incredulity and outrage it fosters with policies protecting trans kids in schools. Of course, no cat children are using litter boxes in schools. The hook, the salacious headline, was an outright lie. Of course, the purpose of it was to sell ads, to sow fear, and to wrest power from those they seek to subdue, subjugate. And sure, after a while, Joe Rogan admitted he had lied, but the damage was done. A moral panic was already underway. And this particular rumor can be traced back to Prince Edward Island, a province in Canada I just found out existed. In a Facebook post made by a public school board in PEI in October 2021, they said that for several months they had fielded
calls, been sent emails, and been pointed to numerous social media posts that make broad, sweeping assertions regarding students who identify as cats. Many of these assertions claim that schools have or are in process of having litter boxes placed in schools.
By the time the subject of the accusations is able to refute the claims made against them, it's already too late. The rumors have gone viral. They can no longer be contained. They can never be retracted. While I was writing this script, I noticed a trend in the replies when claims like these were debunked. A common refrain was, well, even if this one thing was misinformation, I've heard dozens of stories just like this. And one of them actually replied and said, the stories just like this are exactly that. Just like this. Disinformation. I was then called a groomer, told that my opinion was irrelevant because I have pronouns, and then blocked. The truth is, some people have a deep aversion to challenging their own beliefs. And I get it. We all get presented with misinformation online, a fake but seemingly plausible tweet, a satirical article written just too close to reality to immediately discredit, a series of rumors you've heard so many times that's now not only true to you, it's common knowledge. And none of that is limited to impacting only one political group. But at this point in the life of the internet, there's no real excuse for what happens after being exposed to that misinformation. Most widespread claims being made are just a keyword search away. Kitty litter students fact check. Cities burned to the ground fact check. And if there isn't a fact check already written up for you, all the resources are still there to figure it out yourself. No matter where you lay on the political spectrum, we are all susceptible to believing misinformation that confirms our biases. The kind of stuff that you look at and say, okay, well, maybe that didn't happen that time, but I could totally see how it would have happened. I wish we could all rely on the articles we read to be truthful and unbiased, but we can't. That's not to say that there aren't standards for journalists, there are. The incitement of a real war for the purpose of selling newspapers in part helps solidify journalistic ethics in the people who choose to embody them. This led to the birth of the Code of Ethics for Newspapers, a tangible standard to which journalists could be held, a standard for truthfulness in media, which we should be able to expect, but sadly can't. If you want more on that, check out Journalism and Bias by The Leftist Cooks. The fact that we can't trust the media to be truthful is why it's important to be able to recognize malicious gossip when you hear it or see it. Why it's vital that we make sure we check the sources of the information. If the source is unfamiliar or seems a little sus, we have to do some additional research to verify its credibility. If the source has a clear slant or agenda, it's likely that it's trying to present information in a way that is not completely true or completely untrue. It might not be, but to assume either way leaves you open to manipulation, to being conned. Sometimes the deception is obvious. Like, do you think you're going to get unbiased information on trans people from transgendertrend.com? Obviously, we shouldn't automatically believe everything we read online, and we need to be skeptical and critical of the information we're reading. But often our own biases get in the way. I've included some links to fact-checking sites in the description below if you're into that sort of thing. I know that's a basic step for a lot of us, but some people genuinely don't know that you can just Google fact-check alongside a claim. You may have heard the saying, a little gossip never hurt anyone. You may have even got that idea from me because of my podcast. But no, that's just not true. And there's a reason I only gossip about dead people. Steel Manning, I'd say that this saying is trying to express that it's okay to be a little petty sometimes. But that's because petty refers to things that are trivial, of little or lesser importance, and not like the things we've discussed in this episode. Our responsibility lies not only in making sure we don't internalize and believe the rumors, it's important to not participate in it either, especially when it serves to pump up the powerful and demonize the downtrodden. Thank you so much for watching to the end. If you like this video, please subscribe, like, comment, share it. All those things make a huge difference in my life. Like, you don't even know how much that helps creators like me, seriously. I didn't even know until recently. She was ignorant. Also, by the time this airs, my expenses will be around 3 days away from increasing $800 a month due to rent. So I'd love if you slid on over to patreon.com/CaelanConrad, where you can support my channel and get ad-free access to videos without sponsors, as well as perks like your name in the credits of the videos or the ability to hide an item somewhere on my next set. Also, sometimes I take older videos down and I usually leave them up on there. So there's a few extra videos you can check out, including my short film nobody liked. Well, nobody watched. I'm literally not even making minimum wage, and most of my videos are a lot of work. You can also subscribe to my podcast, Respect the Dead, where you drag the corpses of everyone's least favorite dead people, con artists, bootlickers, titans of industry. If you want more information on the power of rumors and stochastic terrorism, as well as folk devils, you should probably watch this video if you haven't seen it yet. I'm incredibly proud of it. See it? Watch it. Click on it.